Don't forget that we've started September, and so that's a new Bible reading that we've started into. And so if you have any questions on that, of course, usually we have a paper around in the foyer, but keep on reading your chapter a day at least, and even doubling up on some of it, going through it. Excuse me, I put a cough drop in there, and it's not wanting to go down. So make sure you're reading your chapter a day. Also, this Sunday, we have the opportunity to have Heartland come over from the Men's Recovery Center that they have over in Heartland, Missouri, to be able to come, share some testimonies, and stir faith on the inside, especially if you know somebody that may be struggling with an addiction and need a testimony of hope. So oftentimes people with addiction say, you have no idea what it's like. And in one sense, I understand that. On the other side of it, I understand who Jesus is. And he's the answer for our problems and our deliverance. And so, but if you know somebody that's struggling with an addiction and they want deliverance and need stir faith up on the inside, I encourage them to come be here on Sunday morning to be able to hear testimonies. And we can rejoice together and to hear some good testimonies, what's going on. Anybody need a good testimony? Amen. And so come and let's rejoice with them. It's a wonderful ministry. And they'll share with us their testimony in the word of the Lord. And so it'll be here this Sunday. And then, of course, we'll give them a love offering to help them in the ministry that they're doing there also. And then 55 plus, sign up in the foyer if you're planning on attending on Sunday afternoon. For the meal there, we encourage you to be a part of that. Last Sunday morning, I asked for people if they would spend an extra hour in prayer this week. And for some of you, I'd ask also if you would, had the time, spend an extra hour in prayer for your pastor too. And so I encourage you to be spending that extra time in prayer. And then we ended the service Sunday basically with encouraging you to give God the gift of your undivided attention. And whether it be for 5 minutes or for 15 minutes, 5 minutes a day, or whatever it might be. And I would want to just remind you of that, because it's so easy when we leave the church that the enemy puts all of these other thoughts into our minds and tries to fill up our schedule with all kinds of other things that seem so important to us. And we just need to make sure that we're taking that. If we don't have time for God now, why should we want to spend eternity with him? Huh? And so I think it's just good for us to make sure we're spending that time with the Lord now, building that into our lifestyle, honoring him by giving him our full, undivided attention for the love that we have for him and respect that we have for him. And so I just want to encourage you to continue to do that. Be praying, be believing, be reading your Bible, and we'll be seeing signs and wonders happen in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me if you would. Let's open in a word of prayer, and we're going to expect God to move supernaturally. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God that desires to move in our life. We come first of all, and we are humbled by the fact that you want to be with us. Lord, I thank you for exposing any sense of pride or arrogance or religious attitude that we might have in our own life. We just come and we thank you that every single one of us have one Savior. We come by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we come into your presence. And so, Lord, we thank you. It's not a church service that we're having, but it is a gathering of believers with the one that we love so much. And so, Holy Spirit, we just thank you for your presence. We come tonight and we ask that you would fill us afresh. We're asking for fresh fire from the altar of God. We're asking for a fresh move of the Holy Spirit in our life. We're asking that you'd be moving amongst us so our conversation changes from consumed about a virus to be consumed about what Christ is doing in this day. Maybe we'd be talking more about those that are healed and raised from the dead and changed and transformed in our life, and Lord, than anything else. May you be glorified. And so tonight, may there be a stirring on the inside of us, not because of a well-crafted sermon, but because of just obedience to the voice of the greater one. Lord, we can't be your voice to the world until we've heard your voice in our heart. And so tonight, speak to us. Tonight, expand the light of the gospel in us. Tonight, reveal the presence of the Holy Spirit present with us, so that these truths are not just theological doctrine, but they are daily way of living by knowing you, experiencing you, and being transformed by you. In Jesus' name, amen.
In the stillness, I know that you are God. In the secret of your presence, I know there I am restored. Praise. All my delight is in. to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. There is no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set.
With every
strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Oh, we just do that right now. We put our full attention on You. Father, we're reminded that whatever holds our attention controls our future. And we want You and You alone to have complete control over our life. And so we thank You, Holy Spirit, for Your presence. Lord, teach us right now, what does that mean to turn our eyes upon You? What does that mean to hold You in full attention? What does that mean to know You, to seek Your face? Lord, right now, speak to our spirit. Reveal to us anything in this world that is taking our attention away from You, whether it's fears, whether it's worries, whether it, dear God, is achievements and wealth, whether it is strategies of the enemy that are distracting us, or whether it's our own plans, Father, that we're trying to fulfill and accomplish. We just thank You for the constant voice of the Holy Spirit that right now is speaking to us, leading us, guiding us step by step, that we are keeping our focus and our attention on Jesus. And we thank You, Jesus, that You are the author and the finisher of our faith. We thank You that we can seek those things which are above, where Christ sits at the right hand of the Father. We thank You as we keep our attention on You, that we're full of faith, we're full of hope, we're full of victory. We've got words of life to share to those that are around us. We've got answers that come from heaven that are able to change and transform the problems and the situations of this world that are around us. We're not limited nor consumed by this world's limitations, but we have heaven's resources flowing through our lives. We are proclaiming the delivering power of God to the world around us. We're speaking health and healing to the needs of people that are around us, and most of all, proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ to a lost world that is around us. And so we thank You, Father, we don't have time to worry. We don't have time to fret. We've got the gospel of Jesus Christ to spread and a great harvest that needs to be brought in. So help us. Help us during this time to keep our eyes on You. Stir within us with that holy fire that burns the chaff up in our life, so that we can be living for something of greater purpose and means than just ourselves. And Holy Spirit, we thank You. You're not just visiting this church. You are inhabiting these people. Lord, we just thank You for the fire of the Spirit of God burning in our hearts. We hunger for You, God. We long for a visitation that turns into a manifestation. It turns into a presence that rests in this place, that transforms and changes our lives by Your glory and grace. So thank You for Your patience in our life, but God, change us so that we might be more like You. And Father, we pray for those that are around us. Lord, that there is no spirit of lukewarmness. There is no attitude of apathy. There is no me-centered mentality. But Lord, we are on fire with God. We are passionate about following You, and we are pursuing the will of God in this day. And we are seeing signs and wonders for Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Turn to someone and tell them, I'm expecting a miracle. I'm expecting a miracle. Oh, Pastor, how can you say that? Well, because the Lord is with us. Amen. And if the Lord is with us, then we might as well be expecting miracles to manifest in our presence, that He desires to do amazing things in us and through us. I said a little sentence in there earlier, and I want you to think about that, maybe even write it down. Whatever holds your attention controls your future. Whatever future. And I know that there's things that happen in life that kind of maybe we glance this way or we glance that way, but what holds your attention will control your future. And that's all up to you, folks. That's all up to you. Whether the Word of God and the Spirit of the Lord in your life holds your attention, whether you're keeping your focus on Jesus. I can't preach good enough sermons on Sunday morning and Wednesday night to hold you all week long. That's you having a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ every day. And as one man said, if you don't worship the Lord every day, you don't worship Him on Sunday. And so we just want to make sure that we are just radical believers in Jesus Christ during this time in life. Amen. Turn with me if you would in your Bibles. Well, just hold on. We're going to go all over before we get there. But if you want to get looking for it, Judges in the Old Testament, Judges chapter 6, we'll get there in a few moments. But I want to talk tonight about strategically moving from hiding to fighting. F-I-G-H-T-I-N-G, fighting. Anybody been in a fight lately? Don't raise your hand. But we move, spiritually speaking, from hiding to fighting. I just want to encourage you as pastor, and I know that this some of these things get online, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, and that's why my prerogative is to minister to the people that are in the room, not that those that hopefully click on online and it all works out by technology or whatever might be there. I want to make sure that we understand, and just over the last couple of days especially, I'm intentionally changing the conversation from a virus to Christ. I'm intentionally changing the conversation. We are allowing a problem to consume our conversation and our thinking and even our debating. And we're leaving Jesus out of everything. And we got to get back to the conversation of Jesus saves, and people are lost and they need to know Jesus and they need to be transformed and changed. And those of us that have Jesus, we ought to be living like we've got Jesus as our Savior in our life. We ought to be having the Word of Christ coming out of our mouth in our life. We ought to be declaring the truth of God's Word out of our mouth in our life. And so as I was preparing for today's message, and it was stirring over me, I was thinking, and the Holy Spirit brought to my remembrance a gentleman that is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. You don't need to turn there, but there's a whole list of people that are known as people of faith. And we understand people like Abraham, you know, as a person of faith. We understand someone like Noah, who is a person of faith. We understand some of those people that we would certainly. But there's someone that's just mentioned in there, and his name was Gideon. Has most of us heard of Gideon before in the Bible? Most of us have heard of Gideon in the Old Testament. And unfortunately, many times we misappropriate what God was using him as an illustration of a man of faith as, and we actually misuse his life in a faithless situation. We might get to that, we'll see. But Gideon was a man of faith. Remember, we are endeavoring to look at Old Testament illustrations, but our focus is on New Testament application. So if it's in the New Testament, and if it's an application we can make that is in line with the New Testament, then we'll bring it from the Old Testament. We can see here's an illustration, a story along that line. And so tonight, I want us to look at this gentleman, many of us know Gideon, and bringing him, God had to strategically. Turn to your neighbor and say, you just need God. You just need God. There's some things that need to go on in people's lives that just God needs to do it. And those things are not just for yourself, but they're for God to use you and prepare you for what needs to be done. And he needed Gideon or someone like Gideon. And so God had to strategically move him from someone who was hiding in a safe place to be able to use him so he could fight against the enemy in a supernatural way. Now, we won't take the whole time to go through the whole story of Gideon, but Judges 6, Judges 7, you can add those to your reading. And you'll remember that Gideon didn't come at the enemy with some superior weapons or even superior in numbers, but he fought in a supernatural way. I'm thinking we need to fight supernaturally. Amen? We need to understand that we need to come out of hiding and step into the spiritual realm. And as the worship team was talking about before service, have on the armor of God and to be able to stand against the enemy, but God's way has to be done by God's people in a supernatural way. And again, the conversation, even amongst Christians right now, is too, let me say it this way, too carnal. We're talking all about natural things. We need to be talking about the supernatural. And sometimes we got to talk about it before we'll see it. Amen? Sometimes we got to start declaring it before we've seen it come to pass. And so in a way tonight, I'm not trying to invoke you or try to bring you to take up your arms to start a revolution, but I am encouraging every one of us that it is time for us to make sure that we're coming out of hiding and that we are going to continue a spiritual resistance against the enemy and demonic forces in our day. That we are a part of the church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. It didn't say how big a church. It didn't say how many in church. It just said the church. And if you're part of the church, then the gates of hell cannot withstand or resist when we push against those. So we need to start pushing in the spirit realm mostly. We need to start pushing and making sure that we are aggressive in what God wants us to do. God needs an army in our day. He needs an army, not just of angels to go around and push back on the kingdom of darkness. God needs an army of spirit-filled, word-talking believers that got the time to get out there and push back on the enemy. A group of people that are willing to stand up and do what needs to be done. He needs an army of individuals like us that aren't just sending angels to do stuff. Thank God for angels. I rejoice over that there's more that are with us than against us when it comes to the demonic forces of this world. We've got the angels of the Lord that still camp around about us. We still have ministering spirits that are sent to minister to those who are heirs of salvation. Thank God for angels. And they do excel in strength and greater than us in many ways. But I want you to know that God still wants a people that are filled with His Spirit, that are proclaiming the word of the Lord, which is the sword of the Spirit coming out of our mouth in faith to be able to push back against the kingdom of darkness. If you'll remember in Luke chapter 10, verses 19 and 20, where the disciples came back, the 70 returned. This was even before the resurrection. We'll get to Gideon in a minute. We just need to lay a little bit of groundwork. If you'll remember, they came back to Jesus, and this was even before the resurrection, and they were amazed that they said, even the demons are subject, you look it up later, are subject to us in your name. Isn't that amazing? That even the demons are subject to us in your name. And Jesus, I beheld Satan who fell from heaven like a lightning, and he's saying, don't be so surprised about the authority that you have there. Hey, this is what you need to be amazed at. This is the conversation we need to stick with, folks. Your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Oh, glory to God. Amen. I mean, it might be tight in your finances right now. Might be have some pains in your body right now. You might have a pain sitting beside you right now. But the fact is that when we've got a knowing on the inside of us that heaven is our eternal home and God's got our name written down on that list, folks, we are enlisted for a bigger purpose in our life, and it should consume us, should transform us in the way that we're living. Even when we have the miraculous going on here, the most miraculous thing is to know that God loves us. He knows us by name. He has a purpose for us, a plan for every single one of us here on this earth. But he said that scorpions and serpents, he said, I've given you the power to tread over those, and nothing shall be able to harm you. Do we believe the word of the Lord? Do we believe the word of the Lord? So in any demonic attack that comes against us, we can resist it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It's not in our own ability. It's not in our own strength. It's not even in our religious achievement. It's in what Jesus has done for us. and that we need to start to exercise it in this day to push back the kingdom of darkness. Remember in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, where Jesus said, "All power is given unto me." Better translation, "All authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth." He's given us his name, which is above every name, every authority. He has given us that name specifically in the kingdom of, or the spiritual realm. We have authority over the kingdom of darkness. Folks, that's why you don't need to know a demon's name that you're dealing with, because you just know the name of Jesus and it's over whatever that name is. You just say, "Oh, what's your name?" Jesus has authority over you, and in his name, I take authority over you. I resist you. I run you out of my house. I take you out of my head. I take you out of my finances. I take you out of my life in Jesus' name. And wherever I go, I am light, and I will push darkness back wherever I go. So we need to understand, we've got to come out of hiding, folks, and we've got to come out, and it has to be a spiritual revelation. There's too many churches that get into a militant mode instead of a spiritual victorious mode. Well, we're out there, we're ready to fight. You want to fight? I'll fight you. You want to fight over eternal security? All right, I'll fight you over that. You want to fight over women preacher? Okay, I'll fight you over that. No, that's not kind of the militant attitude we want. We want the victorious attitude that Jesus wants his church to be walking in this day and age. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22, I think it is, and 23 there, where Jesus Paul is praying that the church would understand that Jesus, the head, is above all things, and he has given the church, his body, the authority to carry out his word. So I think we've made some connections here that in Luke tells us that our victory is spiritual and then is manifested in the natural. I don't want to make it sound like it's just spiritual and we'll never see No, when we have victory in the spiritual realm, then the manifestations will come to pass in the natural realm. I want us to understand that Jesus has all authority that is given to us. There's not a demon that hasn't already been defeated that we're going to come up against. And I want us to understand that it's not just leaving it up to God and his angels to do it, but according to the revelation that Paul gives to the church, we are his body, and that we need to go out and exercise that authority. So with all of that kind of put together, now you could jump back, if you could, to Judges chapter 6. And I want us to look for just a few moments tonight about the Holy Spirit calling us to be the mighty army that God needs us to be today. That there is a kingdom of darkness that we need to push back. There is an invaded force in this world that originally should not be here. Demonic forces should not be here. This world was set up. God put Adam and Eve to rule over this world, and the enemy is an alien force called the kingdom of darkness, Satan and his forces, that came to plague this earth. And we need to push back that force in the spiritual realm and demonstrate the goodness and the greatness of God in this day. That we need to understand that we are the victorious church that Jesus is coming back for. Jesus is not coming back for a hiding church. He's coming back for a fighting church. And we're going to fight right up to the end. We're going to fight right up to the end. And the fight is not just about me and my family. It is about people that are in bondages and darkness and deceptions that the enemy is holding and maybe even has held that way for generations. And it's time for us to rise up and say, "That's enough. Jesus is still Lord. There still is a good God, and he has empowered us to go out there and to transform and change this world." That we're not looking for just Billy Graham or Kenneth Copeland to come and do it when you got the Holy Spirit in your life to do it. And that we arise and do what God has called us to do. Judges chapter 6, starting in verse 11 in just a moment here. We're going to see Gideon, who is in hiding. He's hiding because of the enemy that has been controlling his country. They've been coming in and stealing from them. They would be waiting till the time when they were gathering the harvest, and they'd wait till they gathered the harvest, then the enemy would come in and steal, kill, and destroy. And Gideon is just getting fed up with it. So he's hiding out trying to just survive. Do you know anyone that's just in survival mode right now? They're trying to hide out. just hoping that the enemy won't find, just hoping things just go over their head and that they won't be seen. If they just keep their head down and their mouth shut, maybe nothing bad will happen in their life. But folks, I want you to know it's time for us to stand up, stick up our mouth, and for some of us even open our mouth and to be able to declare what God's word and will is in this particular time. And that, my folks, is not only going to be when the enemy focuses on us, but that's when we're going to see the victory along the way also. There's a couple of things I want you to know before we read this, because most of us know of Gideon, and we won't look at it, but he put out the fleeces where he asked God, you know, make it wet and the ground around it dry, then make the ground dry or vice versa, however it goes there. But I want you to know that there's a difference between, in Gideon's life, there was a difference between asking God for confirmation and doubting God's word. There was a difference between asking for confirmation and doubting God's word. And he was, of course, in the Old Testament. And so in the Old Testament, he did not have the Holy Spirit in him like we have. Oh, thank God for the Holy Ghost. Oh, what a wonderful time we're in today, that we have the Spirit of God living on the inside. Thank God that we don't have to look for a sign out here when he has transformed and given us the earnest, the down payment, the Holy Spirit on the inside of us today. Thankful that we don't have to wait for a hopeful sign to take place here or down the road somewhere, but every day we can walk knowing the greater one's on the inside of us and leading and guiding us. Actually, for us as New Testament believers, we have no biblical grounds to ask God for fleeces. We have no biblical grounds in the New Testament to ask God to give us a sign for something he's told us to do. Now, thank God, we have the Holy Spirit in us. As many as are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. Thank God we have the word that's been given to us. Gideon didn't have the B-I-B-L-E like you and me. So we've got the Bible. Sometimes Christians ask for signs because they're too lazy to listen to God for themselves. And there's a danger when we ask for signs because there is a God in this world system that can manipulate things out here in the world way and can perform signs, lying signs and wonders, the Bible calls them. And so it's better to be led by the Spirit on the inside that can't lie, won't lie, never lies, than to put your confidence in something out here that you're putting confidence and hope in. So, and if you want to straighten me out afterwards, that's wonderful. We'll pray for you and we'll deal with things there. So if you have questions on that, but I'm very concerned when Christians are asking God for a sign when he has given us his word and his Spirit on the inside. You want a sign? The Holy Spirit in you. There's your sign. Amen? Spirit of truth in you. He'll lead and guide you into all truth. No New Testament illustration after the day of Pentecost do we have an illustration or an application of sign or of asking for a sign. Signs in the New Testament after Pentecost were for the world to say, hey, look, something supernatural is happening in your life. Signs are supposed to follow believers. Believers aren't supposed to follow signs. Amen? All right, well, we'll move on. I think I covered that one enough along here. Let's look at this. Judges chapter 6. We're moving from hiding to fighting. Judges chapter 6, verse 11. I'm reading out of the Amplified Translation. Now, the angel of the Lord. Now, I know there's some discussion here. This very well was an angel from the Lord. But it is also, when it is spoken of as the angel of the Lord, this could be a manifestation of Jesus before he had an earthly body. And so either way, God's speaking to him here. And it says, the angel of the Lord came to him, sat under an oak tree, which belonged to Joaz. And the son of Gideon was beating wheat in the winepress instead of the threshing floor to hide it and to save it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said, "The Lord is with you, O brave man." Will you turn to someone and just tell them, "The Lord is with you, you brave person, you brave person. The Lord is with you." Let me ask you real quickly, what made him brave? The Lord's presence with him. The Lord's presence with him. Do you have the Lord's presence with you? Gonna get a better groan out of somebody on that one. Do you have the presence of the Lord with you? Let me try one more time. Do you have the presence of Almighty God with you? I didn't ask you if you felt like it. I didn't ask like if it looked like it. I'm just saying, is this true? The Lord is with you. He's strategically starting to shake his mentality. Because at this point, he's focused on the enemy that was around him. He's focused on trying to hold on to this little bit of stuff he's got right here so nobody gets it from him. Instead of realizing the Lord is with him. That changes everything. The Lord is with you, he said, you brave man or mighty man of valor. Then Gideon said to him, "Please, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, then why has all this happened to us?" Isn't it interesting how quickly we want to question the word of the Lord because of what's happening in our life instead of change what's happening in our life because of the word of the Lord. We question, "God, if your word's true, then why is this happening to me?" Instead of saying, "God, your word is true. This needs to change what's happening to me." The difference, and we understand the Lord is with us, his presence transforms and changes us. Where we have a spirit of faith or valor or brave, where we're starting to fight for the things of God instead of argue with and complain to God. And he says, why is all this happening to us? And where are all his wondrous works, which our fathers have told us about in old? And they said, Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? And now the Lord has abandoned us and put us into the hand of the Midians. And the Lord turned and said to him, "Go in the strength of yours and save Israel from the hand of the Midians. Have not I said?" But Gideon said to him, "Please, Lord, how am I to rescue Israel? Behold, my family is the least significant in Manasseh, and I am the youngest, the smallest in my father's house." And the Lord answered and said, "I will certainly be with you, and you will strike down the Midianites as if they were only one man." And Gideon replied to him, "If I have found favor in your sight, then show me a sign that you who speak to me." So we pull this apart for just a few moments tonight and understand that even though God is calling him to bring deliverance to his people, but also to answer the problems that he was facing, and even to answer some of the questions he had, but he keeps being in this attitude of it's not going to work because of my disqualifications. When he was hiding there, it was all about how he was seeing himself. I don't know how to say this nicely, but you got to get over you. I got to get over me. He only could see himself in this time. He could only see this little situation that he was, the enemy that was against him, and what had happened in his past, and then he starts to list all of the disqualifications in his life. And the Lord just keeps coming back with this great statement, "I'm with you. I'm with you. But I'm with you. What more do you want than God Almighty on your side?" In the New Testament, we know what that is. If God be for me, it doesn't matter who's against me. It was a revelation and understanding that we need to have, that he was sowing into Gideon here to transform him, to get him out of this hiding survival mentality into this willingness to go out and face the enemy and to be able to deliver his nation and to be able to proclaim the will of God to be done in a supernatural way. Gideon kept asking, what about this lack of the supernatural? While he's talking to an angel. God, why doesn't supernatural things happen anymore? And an angel's talking to him at this particular time. Gideon is reminding God of all of his physical disqualifications. His tribe was not a very significant one. He was the smallest or the youngest in his father's family. These are all reasons why you can't use me, God. And God keeps saying, you're not the qualification here. My presence with you is what is going to bring the victory in your life. We need to stir that up on the inside of us, folks. It's God's presence with us. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Gideon needed more proof than God's word. He said, this is great. Actually, in one sense, right there before him was the answer of all of Gideon's prayers and complaints. And what did he do? I need more of a sign. Folks, if we would get a hold of the reality of God's word and his presence with us, it would transform our lives in the spirit of faith that we would have, that it doesn't matter what's against us, it doesn't matter our inabilities or what we would call disqualification in our life, we would understand if God said it, then he was going to watch over his word to perform it. It's not about me. It is about Almighty God and him getting the glory along the way. So here we go. God speaks to him, and certainly he's gracious in the Old Testament, gives him the signs and to confirm the word. But for folks, us in the New Testament, we don't need any more conforming signs out here. We've got the word. We just need a revelation of the word. The longer you entertain what's not from God, the longer you postpone what is from God. The longer we meditate upon, well, why don't we see any signs and wonders? Why, Lord, why are these bad things happening to me? Lord, you can't use me because of my inabilities or my physical whatevers. And we look at all, meditating on all of the things that aren't from God in our life postpones what God wants to do in our life. So tonight, as I'm calling for an army, I'm not calling the qualified, I'm simply calling those that have God in their life, that will say that it is enough. I'm not staying in my hole any longer. I'm not going to just complain about what isn't. I'm not going to complain even about the enemy, but I'm going to start to say, God, I know what your word declares, and I want to be a part of that in this day and in this hour. I want to move forward and experience the signs and the wonders and the miracles. I'm not making light of Gideon in any way. I just want for us to stop for a moment and ask ourselves. This is Wednesday night, folks. Just stop and pause for just a moment. Is there any area in my life that I'm postponing what God wants to do because I've been meditating on the wrong things? That I've been focused on the wrong areas? That I've been abandoning the word of the Lord for the disqualifications that I hear myself saying about myself? That I need to get over me so I can go and do what he's created me to do and to be in a way that causes him to get the glory. What has God spoken to you lately that he wants you to do that you're hesitant to do? I can't believe that God isn't speaking to hearts about doing more. I'm not just talking about getting more involved in church. That's wonderful, and we need to be more involved. Turn your neighbor and just tell him, he's talking to you. He's talking to you. You know, we need to get more involved. There's nothing wrong. But But folks, these are the days that God wants to do more than just get a choir together to sing once a month. He's wanting us to get out there and to proclaim His glory every day in a way that draws attention to His greatness in your life. God wants to do more than just have you maybe minister on a Wednesday night, He wants you to be used in a way that is going to make a supernatural difference. Maybe that starts in the prayer time. Maybe that starts, well, I guarantee it does, but with you, maybe it is spending more time in prayer. If you don't have more time to pray, you don't have more time for God to use you in any way. If you don't have more time to pray, you do not have time for God to use you in any way. Because prayer time not only prepares the thing that God wants to do, it starts to transform and change you. Because when we're in His presence is where real transformation starts to go on. So he needed to get Gideon to start to change. And so he speaks to Gideon in this quiet time and starts to challenge him and prepare him to go out and to be able to change the world, to fight against the adversaries that was around. But he was going to do it in a way that was not logical. He was going to do it in a way that didn't make sense. We know that Gideon went and in chapter 7, he goes on and he calls people that were ready to say, let's make a change. I think people are rising up and saying, we need to make a change. And not just in the political realm, I'm talking even in the church realm. It's time for change in the church. Not a pastor's, hopefully not, but it's time for a change, for a move of God to be a manifestation. That we get past this, we just kind of hang out and hold out until Jesus comes. But let's rise up and be the army of God in this particular time. And so he calls a group of people and he gets tens of thousands of people that come together and said, we're ready to go. And God said, that's wonderful. That's too many. I've never, ever heard a preacher like this portion of scripture. Because we always like it when the house is full. We like it when there's a lot of people. God says, that's too many. If you go out with that many people, then you'll think you made the achievement. You will think that you did what you did because of your abilities. So you need to simply ask the people, if there's anybody that's afraid to fight, that really doesn't want to do this, go on home. And the vast majority of them left. And God still said, there's way too many. And so he gave them, he said, hey, when take them to have a drink, and if they drink a certain way, keep them. If they don't, send them home. And so eventually Gideon comes down with 300 people. Can you imagine that? But something has changed in Gideon. We never see him questioning God from that moment from original. With 300, if God's with us, it's more than enough. Isn't it interesting with our mental capability how we calculate things and God uses different math than we do? God says with 300 going against a superior force, that's about right. We can work with this. He does things like one will put 1,000 to flight and two will put 10,000 to flight. That's new math for me, folks. I don't know that one. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. That's incredible. Some of these things. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Isn't that incredible? The things that he puts on the inside of us stirs on the inside of us. But God kept saying it's still too many, it's still too many. And then finally gets down to the 300. And they go out and they have an incredible, miraculous deliverance for the people. It was because of their obedience, their willingness to fight in a way that God led them. Now, I want you to know they would have utterly been destroyed if they would have said, no, it's not with clay jars. We got to have sharp swords to be able to do this. No, we can't go out there with just a trumpet. We got to go out there. We got to do it in a... Let's get real about this now. You know, Gideon, you've done pretty good up to this point, but let's be smart. Let's get logical. This is the way wars are won. This is the way battles are won. We need to go back to the proven method. But I want you to know that as we go forward with God, He's going to ask us to do things that are illogical, that don't make sense, that But there's a leading on the inside and a knowing on the inside of us that God's with us. He said to do it this way, and he'll get the most glory when we do it his way on the way. And so Gideon goes, and he stands against this enemy. And they have a tremendous victory, and God gets the glory. I think it's interesting that John Wesley was the one that said, if I had 300 men that fear nothing but God, hate nothing but sin, and determined to know nothing among men but Christ and his crucifixion, I would set the world on fire. Amazing. I wonder what God could do with 30 of us in the Quincy area. 30 of us that knew nothing but God, hated nothing but sin, determined to know nothing among people except Christ and him crucified. I wonder if we could set our community on fire. Why don't we think that way if the Lord is with us? Why aren't we beseeching the Lord and asking, how can you do this in our day? How can you do it through us in a powerful way? How can you do it? Show us so that we crawl out of our hiding and we humbly ask the Lord to move supernaturally among us, that there are still people that need to be saved. There are people that need to be set free. The greater one is on the inside of us. He has created us for such a time as this. It's no matter. He told Gideon, when you go against that enemy and you fight against him, it's going to be just like one person. Not a whole army, just one person standing out there. And I want you to know there's just one that stood against us, Satan himself. And Jesus has already defeated that one. And so with the greater one in us, when we go against the kingdom of darkness, we go against a defeated one that we can overcome. And God wants to move supernaturally in our day. He wants the church to be seen, not just by us doing good deeds, not just by us being able to take care of a few natural things in our community, but for the power of the Spirit of God being seen in our lives and signs and wonders and miracles to be accomplished and to be done. The question is, are we willing to be the ones? Remember the verse there in Ezekiel 22:30, and I want to read it out of the Amplified Translation. I know we're running out of time here tonight. I'm coming to an end to this. As we're calling ourselves out of hiding, and maybe we think we are out in some ways, and yet Holy Spirit reveal us if there's areas of our life that we have become in self-preservation or just become a lifestyle that we're hiding out and that we need to be challenged by his voice. Listen to this now, the Amplified Translation, Ezekiel 22:30 says, I search, this is God speaking, I search for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand in the gap before me. For the sake of the land, that I would not destroy it. And here are these sad words. But I found no one, not even one. Not even one. I just wonder, how does that verse hit you tonight? Do you feel like the Holy Spirit is starting to stir on you to be one, be the one that he can use in this day? The only qualification that Ezekiel 22 said that God looked for is someone willing. Again, we have so many disqualifications. We should just, if I had the time, we'd just pause right now and just start giving me your disqualifications. I could probably just start even over in this section. Just start at people. Well, why can't God use you? What thoughts are going through your mind? I know this group over here, they're all holy, and there's no thoughts like that over here. But what are some of those disqualifications? Why can't God use you? And we start to have them, but when we start to say them out of our mouth, we just realize how silly that is. That we are saying that God can't use us because of, and you fill in the blank, or some of you it's multiple blanks, but those are all, it doesn't matter. Here, I mean, I know we're getting probably tired of this, but turn to your neighbor in honesty and say, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. God still can use you. It doesn't matter. God can still use you because he's God and he's the source, the resource. He just said, I'm looking for someone that will just stand in the gap, someone that will do my bidding here on this earth. Are you too busy? Do you think you're not qualified? Do you think you've not been good enough? What is it? Do you think you've got too much sin in your life? What is it? I don't know. But I want you to know, this is the amazing thing. God wants to use every one of us. God wants to use every one of us. If I could say that God needs to use every one of us in this day and this hour. God needs to stir on the inside of us. The hand of the Lord is still upon his church, even as the hand of the Lord was upon Gideon. The Spirit of the Lord is still in his body, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, and us individually here in this day. The word of the Lord is still to call deliverance to those that are oppressed and to set the captives free as Jesus did on this earth. That's the work we must be a part of in this day and age. The Spirit of the Lord still wants to speak through us and still wants to use us. Do you want to be used of the Lord? Do you want to come out of hiding and to be able to be a part of what God wants to do in this day? Are you willing to just be one? To say, God, whatever it is you want me to do. I would challenge you, and just in closing, I challenge you tonight. Probably most of us aren't going to be a Gideon and stand in the front of an army of 300 to stand against the enemy. But there had to be the 300 there. There had to be those 300 that were willing to follow after him. There had to be those 300. There had to be the 70 disciples that Jesus sent out. There had to be the 70. There had to be the 120 in the upper room to be able to have the day of Pentecost to come upon them. There had to be those that were used of God. Are you willing in this day to be used in a supernatural way? Now, please, don't misunderstand me. I think we need to be involved in good works. We need to be involved in feeding the poor. We need to be involved in clothing people. We need to be involved in helping individuals. I'm not opposed to that 100%. I'm with there. But what can only the church do in this day? What can only the church do in a way that God gets the glory in this day? I want you to ask yourself, maybe you've already got your extra hour of prayer in, but here's a short prayer I want you to be asking the Lord. What is it that you want me to do? And have a willing heart to do it. What is it you want me to do? If you want to get really serious, ask the Lord this. What is it that he needs done that no one else wants to do? What is it that he needs done in his kingdom that no one else is willing to do? No one else wants to do it for whatever reason. And I'm not even going to give you a list of possibilities there. But could God use you? Could he? Yes. Why wouldn't he use you? He didn't save us just to go to church. He saved us so we would be the church, that we would be his body, be his voice, and that we would be the resistance against the kingdom of darkness while we're here on this earth. He's called you for a bigger purpose than just surviving. He's called you for a greater plan. And you might say, well, I don't know what God's destiny for my life is. Here's God's destiny for your life. Be used of God. And whatever needs to be done. Lord, what is it you want me? Lord, what is it that you want me to do? And this has been my prayer. Lord, what is it you want me to do? And Lord, what is it that you need to be, that you want to be done, that no one else is willing to do it? Show it to me, so I can do it for you, and do it in a way that he gets the glory. Heavenly Father, we just pause. To Lord, right now, to some, you're speaking to their hearts at this very moment. That there is not a task too great nor too small if it is of your voice that you're speaking to us. You're reminding us, like Gideon, you call us mighty men and women of valor, brave because the Lord is with us. Our courage and our confidence, it's not on the number of scriptures that we've memorized. but is the reality the Lord is with us. Holy Spirit, we're asking for clear instruction, clear voice, that we know it is you speaking to us without a doubt. What is it that you want us to do individually? And Lord, we even open it up corporately as a church. What do you want us to do? And is there something that needs to be done that no one else is willing to do? Give it to us. Give us the assignment. Because, Lord, if you give us the assignment, then we are confident that you will give us the anointing, the hand of God upon us, to be able to do the miraculous for your glory. Lord, we're not here to complain about the lack of signs and wonders. We're here to say thank you for being the God of signs and wonders that is with us. We're not here to complain about the enemy and what's killing and stealing and destroying our world. We're here to say it's time to rise up and to be the church and to supernaturally resist the enemy and see the hand of the Lord in this day and in this hour. Lord, we're here to say we're not going to do it with just logic. We're not going to do it here with a good business program. We're going to do it in a way that you are glorified, that you are exalted, and that we will encourage others that you can do it too, because it's the same Holy Spirit who's in you. So we receive your assignments in Jesus' name. Amen. Write those down, whatever they are. Write them down. Ask God to help you to do it, and then get after it. And any thought that comes to your mind, I can't because, you need to say, that's not going to stop me because the greater one's with me. That's not going to stop me because the greater one's with me in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. God bless you. Love you. Thank you for being an incredible church. Go out there, since you've come out of hiding, go out there, go out fighting today, tonight, folks, and let the adversary know he's on the run. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you Sunday morning.